I came across a line the other day that stopped me cold. Let me read it to you. Nothing fails like success. While you're turning that around in the back of your mind, let me remind you of something else that made me stop and think for a while. I think it was from the distinguished professor, now retired from Columbia University, Dr. Sidney Hook. He said, to the best of my memory, in effect, there's nothing wrong with a little anticipation. The real tragedies in life occur when we get what we want. So let's take these two thoughts as our subjects for the moment. Nothing fails like success, and while there's certainly nothing wrong with anticipation, the real tragedies in life come about when we get what we want. These two statements would seem to run counter to everything we tend to believe, especially in the United States. Let's take them one at a time, if that can be done. Nothing fails like success. The quotation is attributed to Gerald Hurd, author of such outstanding books as The Five Ages of Man, The Psychology of Human History, Gabriel and the Creatures, Pain, Sex, and Time, New Outlook on Evolution and the Future of Man, and others. We're recommending that you read The Five Ages of Man, and we're listing his other books in case you'd want to collect all of his works. He's an original and distinguished investigator into the beginnings of our species and why we're the way we are, and incidentally, how we could be a lot better. I found the quotation in another book I'm going to recommend that you read. It's a small paperback written by an educator, Warren Stutzel. The title of the book is School for the Young. Warren Stutzel writes, "One of the dangers of evolutionary success is that no matter how well it may have served a creature, any device, if it can be called that, may simply run away, go to extremes, and become the eventual Achilles heel for the species. Such has been the case with fangs and claws, with saber-toothed tigers and mastodons sporting their great giant curling tusks. Such is the case now with the trigger-happy response mechanism of the killer whale. Claws and teeth may have their uses, but only up to a certain size. They can, and they do, become unwieldy. A quick response may have its uses, too, but when it must be so quick that the creature has no choices whatsoever, then, as with the killer whale, a creature has been lured down the narrowing passage of too limited response. It's built within itself its own destruction. It is not defense at any cost that has worked. The fossil record is full of those who went that way. Not even success has a very good record, as the earth keeps records. Survival in the long, long run has favored the timid, the unfinished, the flexible, the vulnerable. If Darwin was right that the fittest survive, we must add to that statement a more accurate definition of what it is to be fit. To be fit for survival is to be unspecialized. And to remain unspecialized is to refuse the lure of too complete success, the bait of absolute security, the temptation of unbending toughness, the rush to maturity." When I read that part about survival in the long, long run favoring the timid, the unfinished, the flexible, the vulnerable, I couldn't help thinking of the line from Matthew, "Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth." Then if survival favors the unfinished, the flexible, the vulnerable, then surely man must be safe. Well, Warren Stutzel goes on to say that he's the youngest of all the creatures, born younger than the chimpanzee or any of the apes. He's their child form. He's wonderfully unspecialized. He has no fangs, no claws, no unfailing built-in reflexes of savage attack or devastating defense. No organ, no power has run away, grown out of size, out of balance. So it would seem. But it may not be so. Voices of serious doubt have been raised. They're not the prophets of doom, but they're sounding a serious warning. Man is out of balance. Man is in danger of specializing. Man is emulating the creatures who failed. And he's doing it with his now most potent organ, his brain. Dr. A.T.W. Simmons calls it man's presumptuous brain. Dr. Simmons is a specialist in psychosomatic disease at the Salvator Mundi International Hospital in Rome. His book received international acclaim when it appeared in 1961, presenting a theory which explains psychosomatic diseases in terms of evolutionary stresses. It's no doubt common knowledge today that psychosomatic factors are more common than any other in our illnesses and in our deaths, yet they trouble no other species. Even contagious diseases, Dr. Simmons found, may depend upon psychosomatic factors for their spread. Cholera serves as an example. The microbe which causes cholera is killed almost instantly by acid as strong as normal stomach acid. Cholera, which thrives in the alkaline condition of the small intestine and accomplishes its killing business there, should not be able to pass through the acid stomach. But it does. And the reasons are psychosomatic. Fear and panic shut off the flow of acid in the stomach. Those most fearful of the cholera, most fearful of the death it may deal, become its victims. In an Asian epidemic, those too young to understand or too old or wise to panic have the best chance for survival. Millions of years ago, first around the olfactory sense and then later serving the other senses, two new lobes of brain tissue began to develop. Unlike the early reptilian brain to which they were added, they did not control the basic functions of the creature, such things as breathing, digestion, instincts. They had quite another function, and it can be summed up in one word, censorship. They would intercept irrelevant sensory messages. To varying degrees, this new brain development is present in every mammal. It's what we call the cerebral cortex, and in man has grown to be the overwhelmingly predominant part of his brain. To serve well, the new censoring center had to have a memory, and with memory, a system for handling associative processes. The creature had to be able to remember, now that it had moved into the trees, that, ah yes, that critter used to be a threat, but not now. Of course, it was not really like that, but leave out the language and the sensory message. After it had run through the new censoring center, came out with the same directive. The tree creature could go back to sleep. Eventually, he might not even wake in the first place. The capacity for combining experiences developed. With effective censorship came what we recognize today as the ability to learn. It resulted in conscious perception as against unconscious response. It gave to us, man, the possessors of the supreme censoring center, our memory, power of association, a kind of learning, and reasoning. Now, still intact beneath this giant cortex, a cortex with enough brain tissue in its folds and creases that, if stretched out, it would enclose a barrel. Still intact beneath it is the primitive brain stem. And Simmons points out that you could remove the massive cortex, and if the surgery were skillful enough, and if shock were not fatal, the human being would remain alive. Breathing would continue, as would digestion and elimination. The eyes would blink if an object passed too close, but the person would not see what passed before his eyes, and he would not be conscious of his functions. His skeletal muscles would move in response to heat or touch, but the person could not move them. If, however, you were to remove the much smaller brain stem, then, of course, death would be instantaneous. The most important of the divisions of the so-called primitive brain is the diencephalon. Now, how important it was for physical functions, we may have had some notion in the past, but the real inquiry into the diencephalon is just now blooming. Dr. Gene Pfeiffer of the University of Kansas predicts that research concerning the diencephalon is likely to become the major brain research over the next 10 years. Why? It's because the diencephalon is the center for all regulatory adjustments. It is in the diencephalon that fear, rage, hunger, sex, and all the other so-called instincts are translated into activity. But one must be asking, haven't we really taken care of these? Certainly all good and responsible people have. Franklin Delano Roosevelt advised us how many years ago that we had nothing to fear but fear itself, and of course he was right. Who goes around being afraid? Rage? Why, only the lunatic rages. Hunger? We have plenty to eat, and anyone can control his appetite. Well, almost anyone. As for sex, it used to be a problem, of course, or it has just become one, depending on your age and point of view. So why raise all these old matters? Well, the doctor has his reasons. They're making us sick and killing us, that's all. One must wonder why, if the other mammals made the same turn, they are not with us in the psychosomatic bind. Simmons gives his guess at the reason. The other mammals didn't go as far with the cortical excursion as we did. They may have made their mistakes, they may have engaged in their own evolutionary excesses, but they left the cortical one to us. When a smooth working balance was achieved between sensory input, diencephalonic impulse, and censorship's revised interpretation of things, well, further growth of the censoring capacity ceased for the other mammals. They stopped with coordinated cooperation of the system. Again, let's step back a few hundred million years, back to the reptile in the trees. Simeon sees this tree phase in much the same light as Lauren Isley saw the island, a place of respite, a chance for the most unlikely of creatures to take on the shape of the future. Simmons describes tree life as the life of animated leisure. Making one's living was easy. Dinner or supper was never far away, never took long to gain. The old enemies could not reach one. It was an island time, a growth time. And what did the tree creatures do with it? They played. They frolicked, experimented. They developed keener and broader sensory acuity. They practiced and thus developed better nervous control. They improved their coordination. Man's capacity for play was born then and given deep root, and it served him well. The tree creatures, Simeon guesses, played not just when they were young, but throughout a lifetime. The brain grew, and it was a good servant. It was no problem. Not till, using all this play-one capacity, man created culture. Not till culture began its rocketing rise in our relatively recent history, that's when the trouble started. That's when the diencephalon and the life-saving cortical sensor began to conflict. Culture demanded new rules, new restrictions, new behavior. Now, that was nothing new, of course, but what was new was that culture came on so fast. This man-made artificial world changed at a rate that the natural world did not, and it asked changes at a rate far beyond what evolutionary processes could achieve. So man launched upon a new use of the sensor, and this is critical. To measure up to his own man-made demands, man turned to a second level of censorship. Now, in the first level, a sensory message was processed and judged in the light of current experience. Its message was recognized. If it warranted action, action ensued. But if it did not, action was denied. The important factor in this process is the impulse. Whether acted upon or denied action, the impulse was recognized. With the second level of censorship, the sensor simply erased consciousness of the message. This became censorship of awareness. The former regulation of impulse becomes now unawareness that the impulse even exists. With this kind of censorship, man becomes able to convince himself that he's quite another being. He's able to separate himself from the animal world and at the same time attempts a lofty existence above his own body. He would, at times and places in his history, deny his bond with either or live as far beyond that bond as possible. Part of his revisionism was his assumption of the stance of the toughest little creature on earth. We know from the evolutionary studies that his distant origins are in some of the most timid of all creatures. The psychophysical makeup he bears today is, at its deepest levels, the one he inherited from them. So contrary to his evolutionary past was man's new claim to ferocity, that he had to devise tools to accomplish his new tasks of murder and mayhem. He had no adequate weaponry as part of his physical makeup. His body, like his diencephalon, was that of a defenseless creature who survived by sensory acuity, by quickness of wit, and by coordination of muscle and mind in escape. No tusks or claws or even trigger reactions were his. He was an expert at flight. And that is what his diencephalon went right on telling him to do as he brazenly toughed his way into belligerence. Flee, the diencephalon shouted, and still shouts, as it gears the whole body mechanism for flight. The diencephalon still faithfully does the job it learned to do. It gears the body for the getaway. But we stand our ground, and the strongest among us, with the gears stripping away inside, never know the diencephalon is there. They just suffer the psychosomatic ailments or the ennui of this life. They name their machines and their battles after the creatures they emulate most, the killers and the carnivores, the very creatures that we know are among the late comers to this earth and will be among the first to leave. With the second level of censorship by the cortex, we've succeeded in forgetting who we are and in creating a behavior which is contrary to the great sweep and direction of our past. Late into the competition, without flesh-formed weaponry, we have put on what Hans Haas in the book The Human Animal convincingly describes as artificial limbs and organs. All our tools and weapons, all the devices by which we extend our power and activity. Late into the competition, without the split-second offensive or defensive reaction, we've built mind machines to program our violent response. Our modern defense systems are the very epitome of killer whale mentality, and they have the same prospects for long-range viability for survival. Like the killer whale, the military machine today strikes where the electronic sensor reveals a twitch of life. It strikes with a vengeance. It does not see. And the men who run it do not feel. It is all automated, just like the killer whale. It's all so cool and right. But the diencephalon does not see it that way. The diencephalon cannot see it that way. The diencephalon never will be able to see it that way. And the diencephalon's revolt is underway. Because of the extreme success of our second level of censorship, which obliterates consciousness of inner needs and objections, the single greatest mystery to modern man is himself. So effective is his censorship that even when he wants to know and feel his own body, he cannot. The voice of his spirit fares no better than his silenced body. It can rarely get past the censor. But, Warren Stetzel writes, this is changing. We are beginning to understand that however one may dominate his total self with his own little dictatorship, his interior ego, cortical complex, this dictatorship is like all the rest. It sits upon a mounting and inevitable and irrepressible revolt. The cortical censoring capacity and tendency seems now to have reached a peak of development, a development that is so out of balance, so unmatched by other powers in us, that we find ourselves in as bad a crisis as man has ever faced. We live today in the time when the censor analyst in us takes everything apart. When left to its own devices, it opens and finds meaningless every bond, every decency, every value, every restraint. It exploits childhood and resents youth and dreads old age and drives the final wedge between mind and body. Well, that was a long quote, but I couldn't find any way of shortening it and still maintain its meaning. I suggest you order a copy of the book School for the Young. It's a paperback from Mr. Stetzel. You'll find it listed in our recommended reading list, and that you let it stretch your mind the way it has mine. If we've become our own worst enemies, censoring out the best part of life, we want to know about it and to try to do something about it. We can perhaps find our island time again. Nothing fails like success carried too far into too narrow a specialization. It can make us grotesque, and it can kill us off. Now back to Professor Sidney Hook's comment that while a little anticipation is a good thing, the real tragedies in life come about when we get what we want. Like our first quotation, it's a generalization. Certainly achieving some of the things we've set our hearts upon brings us great happiness and fulfillment. Getting married to the person we love, watching a youngster graduate from school, buying the home we've dreamed of for so long, a raise in pay, these personal things like Christmas morning are wonderful. But what he had reference to, I believe, ties in with what Mr. Stetzel has to say in his book, School for the Young. We thought an advanced technology would provide the answers to our dreams. It hasn't. We thought it would bring about more leisure and a kind of beautiful civilization. It hasn't. We've kept thinking over the centuries that as each new and more terrible weapon was invented, that it would at last put an end to war, which was another way of saying, since we've got the weapon, we can rule the world, or at least hold it in a kind of subjection. But each new weapon has quickly proliferated around the world and made each succeeding war more devastating, more cruel and costly. And finally, when we at last harnessed the energy of the sun itself, we felt that in this bright new atomic age, ushered in by the incineration and maiming of hundreds of thousands of helpless and innocent victims, we would at last find the millennium of peace and prosperity and abundance, especially following so auspicious and well-produced mass human sacrifice, only to find ourselves cowering in backyard bomb shelters and involved in a frenetic worldwide race to produce more and even more deadly weapons of destruction. Today, as I speak these words, the world stands in perhaps worse shape than it has ever been in before. We're daily and systematically killing the great breeding oceans of the world now that we've finished off most of the lakes and rivers. Everywhere on Earth, men and women are at odds with each other, and millions live in a perpetual state of poverty and starvation. Most of the people on Earth live in ugly, teeming cities, breeding toxic, polluted air. We've achieved everything we've set our hearts upon. And as Professor Hook commented, while there's nothing wrong with a little anticipation, the real tragedies occur when we get what we want. It's obvious, isn't it, that we've wanted the wrong things? We've meant well, as a rule, but as Warren Stetzel put it, we've been overriding our natural instincts and tendencies, telling ourselves we're something we're not. Anticipation we need. It's what keeps us going. It gives interest and challenge and excitement to our lives. Life wouldn't be much without anticipation, without goals toward which to struggle, but what shall our goals be? Someplace in the book School for the Young appears a line I made a note of. It goes, "The graceful living of a life from birth through death in a world we love and preserve." Isn't that what we want for our children? A graceful life from birth through death in a world we love and preserve. Isn't that about it? Getting back to Warren Stetzel's book again for a moment, let me repeat just that one part that goes, "No tusks or claws or even trigger reactions are his. He was an expert at flight, and that's what his diencephalon went right on telling him to do as he brazenly toughed his way into belligerence. Flee, the diencephalon shouted, and still shouts as it gears the whole body mechanism for flight. The diencephalon still faithfully does the job it learned to do. It gears the body for the getaway. But we stand our ground, and the strongest among us, with the gears stripping away inside, never know the diencephalon is there. They just suffer the psychosomatic ailments, or the ennui of this life. They name their machines and their battles after the creatures they emulate most, the killers and the carnivores, the very creatures that we know are among the late comers to this earth and will be among the first to leave. A child stands terror-stricken at the prospect of a fight. Everything natural within him is screaming for him to get out of there, to run, to get back in a tree where he'll be safe. But his father, his society, his recently invented culture tells him to stand there. Fight. Be a man. Don't be a coward. You don't have the fighting equipment of a shrew, but fight anyway. Fight and lose, or fight and win, but fight. How did we get on the wrong track to that second level of censorship, the censorship of awareness? Well, as Warren Stetzel writes, because of the extreme success of our second level of censorship, which obliterates consciousness of inner needs and objections, the single greatest mystery to man is himself. And so effective is his censorship that even when he wants to know and feel his own body, he cannot. The voice of his spirit fares no better than his silenced body. It can rarely get past the censor. I think this is important information, don't you? I think just knowing that second level of censorship is there can help us know ourselves better and have more confidence in the inner impulses that try to get through. There's nothing shameful or cowardly about not wanting to fight. It's as natural to us as breathing. War is an unnatural invention of man, a concomitant of culture, of living in an unnatural way and developing unnatural appetites. I read recently this rather interesting statement. So-called sexual problems are often caused by power conflicts between two persons and can only be solved by unraveling the complex interactions between them. There is no sex per se. Sex is connected with every other function. There is no sex per se. There is nothing about us that can be isolated from the entire organism. If we're healthy animals in touch with ourselves, all of our functions will be healthy. But how do you get beyond that second sensor? I suppose that's the function of psychoanalysis and psychiatric and psychological treatment, to peel away the phony layers like the dirty and discolored outer skin of an onion to reveal what is clean and pristine, what is basic and good underneath. So it would seem that culture carries with it pollutants of an unexpected kind, pollutants of the psyche, which stem from the overdevelopment of our cerebral cortex, like the great self-destructive fangs of the saber-toothed tiger or the painfully involuted tusks of the warthog. Our most successful evolutionary achievement is turning on us. Nothing fails like success.